Hello, I'm Victoria Fritz. In the business news this afternoon, urgent talks end without agreement. Eurozone finance ministers will now discuss a plan proposed by creditors. Greece's Prime Minister Alexis Tsipras says he is convinced that he will clinch a deal with the country's lenders to overcome the debt crisis. More than 38 million people travelled through Gatwick Airport last year. It was the busiest year in the airport's history. The results come just days before the Airports Commission is expected to make its recommendation on how the government should tackle the crunch in airport capacity in the southeast of England. And The Telegraph is reporting that BT wants to loosen industry regulations to allow them to better compete with US internet companies like Apple and Facebook. The telecoms giant is planning to move all domestic and business customers to internet-based voice calls within a decade. But under current Ofcom rules, it must continue to provide a traditional phone service. Now, David Cameron has come under fire for planning to redefine child poverty. Under the current definition, a child is deemed to be living in poverty if they're in a household with an income of less than 60% of the national average. But the government is considering plans to change the way that this is measured. Now, at the moment, almost one in six children are living in poverty, about 2.3 million. It's the same level it has been since 2011-2012. The Work and Pension Secretary Ian Duncan-Smith said that UK poverty levels were now at their lowest since the mid-1980s, but he also added that the government is going to be taking action to address the problem of low pay following the publication of some figures today showing that average household incomes are at an 11-year low. Let's speak now to Julia Unwin from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation. She's in Edinburgh for us. Thank you very much for joining us. It's interesting, isn't it? A lot of the debate so far has centred around this measuring of poverty, but shouldn't the government and charities really be looking to tackle the underlying issues and the causation of poverty in the first place?
Well, that's precisely my point. We can all look at spreadsheets, politicians, people like me do that. What matters is what's happening to children and households living in poverty today, and their life chances are hugely restricted. So I'm delighted that the figures have flatlined in the way that we were told today. That's good, but we are the seventh richest country in the world. We must be able to do more about the causes. We must be able to do more about low pay, about poor housing, and about the staggering fact shown in today's figures that households with one disabled person in them are far, far more likely to be poor. Those are all changes we can make. We know how to do it, and it's a question of government and business and charities working together.
So how do we do it then?
Well, I think we need a comprehensive plan. We need to recognise that it is wasteful to have so many people living in poverty, that children growing up in poverty today who face an uncertain future won't be able to contribute to the growth that we need, and that we will never achieve economic growth unless we deal with this issue of persistent, deep-rooted poverty.
Now, these are the first set of figures to fully incorporate the first changes, I suppose, of welfare reforms. Do they show that the government is doing the right thing?
Well, what they show is that the figures have not got any worse, and I'm hugely pleased about that. They do show that we still face some real problems, that freezing benefits was something we were concerned about, and I'm delighted that the strong jobs market has offset that and people are getting into work. But the work they're getting into is often insecure and doesn't get them out of poverty in the long term. Our research shows that 4 out of 5 people who start work in a poorly paid job are still in a poorly paid job 10 years on. That's the figure that should worry us most.
Julia, we're going to have to leave it there, but really interesting to talk to you. Thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you.
Let's check in with some of the other stories around for you today. The energy regulator Ofgem is calling for installation charges of prepayment meters to be abolished. They say that about 40% of suppliers are charging up to £180 for installing prepayment meters. Now, Ofgem claims that these costs are putting many people off switching suppliers. The Japanese car giants Toyota, Nissan and Mitsubishi are expanding a recall of cars to replace airbags. Those have been manufactured by Takata to the rest of the world. Now, over 3 million cars are going to be called back, and they affect about 30 models of vehicles. And staying with cars, McLaren Automotive has reported a threefold rise in profits. Those numbers are largely being driven by more sales in Asia. Let's check in with the market, see what's going on at the moment. And the FTSE down 0.5%. It is doing slightly better than the rest of the European stock markets at the moment. Big falls going on today in the price of Brent crude. It's fallen through the $63 a barrel mark, down 2.5% at the moment. That will be dragging down some of the oil stocks that are sort of big constituent parts of the FTSE. So perhaps that's why there's been a bit of a weakness today. But stock markets in America at the moment are rising. Some very good numbers when it comes to household spending. The best figures for 6 years. That's it from me. I'm going to have a full roundup of all the markets data in an hour's time. I'll see you then.
Thanks, Victoria. See you later on.